couple of weeks. We were kind of sick. We haven't gone to basketball games at this church the last 2 weeks. We didn't go to the symphony last night.
No, that's what we'll get rid of.
The Lord be with you. Happy Martin Luther King Jr. weekend. It's the second Sunday after the Epiphany. And if you remember, last week we had a visit from John the Baptist and the baptism of Jesus. This week we have a continuation of that, with John the Baptist being reflecting, first pointing to Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, and then reflecting on the events of the day before when he baptized Jesus. We're going to look at that phrase, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. I was going to say something about how terrible my sermon was last night. Hopefully it's better today. I just tried to pack too much into it. Let's prepare our hearts for worship through the brief order of confession and forgiveness found on page 3 of your bulletin. Please rise. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who stretches out the heavens, who sends light to the nations, who gives breath to us all. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Loving God, we confess that we have turned from your way to follow our own ways. Forgive us for the times we have spoken or acted too quickly. We have not spoken or acted at all. We have hurt those closest to us. We have hurt those who have yet to know. We have thought more about ourselves than others. We have thought less of ourselves than we ought. Turn us around and give us a fresh start so that we can live again as your children. Amen. Even when we have done wrong, God makes us right. Even when we have messed up, God puts us together. God's love never runs out. God never tires of calling us beloved children. Hear God say to you now, your sins are forgiven for the sake of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Share God's peace by greeting those around you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
To the Lord.
O
The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Holy God, our strength and our Redeemer, by your Spirit hold us forever, that through your grace we may worship you and faithfully serve you, follow you and joyfully find you. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Christ is the light of the world.
The Holy Gospel according to John, the first chapter. John the Baptist saw Jesus coming toward him and declared, "Here is the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is he of whom I said, 'After me comes a man who ranks ahead of me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, But I came baptizing with water for this reason, that he might be revealed to Israel. And John testified, I saw the Spirit descending from heaven like a dove, and it remained on him. I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water said to me, He on whom you see the Spirit descend and remain is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. And I myself have seen and have testified that this is the Son of God. The next day, John again was standing with two of his disciples, and as he watched Jesus walk by, he exclaimed, Look, here is the Lamb of God. The two disciples heard him say this, and they followed Jesus. When Jesus turned and saw them following, he said to them, What are you looking for? They said to him, Rabbi, which translated means teacher, where are you staying? He said to them, Come and see. They came and saw where he was staying, and they remained with him that day. It was about 4 o'clock in the afternoon. One of the two who heard John speak and followed him was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. He first found his brother Simon and said to him, We have found the Messiah, which is translated anointed. He brought Simon to Jesus, who looked at him and said, You are Simon, son of John. You are to be called Cephas, which is translated Peter. The Gospel of the Lord. You may be seated. I would like to invite the children to come forward. Good morning. I'm going to show you a picture. I'm going to show you two pictures of people who share at least part of their first name. The first picture is this guy. Can anybody tell me who this is? No? Well, it's about, his picture is up there, by the way. That picture was painted by his best friend, Cranach. Cranach was his name. This is Martin Luther. This is a picture of Martin Luther. Now, back in Martin Luther's day, back in the 1500s, they didn't have cameras. The only thing they could do is have paintings. Emerson, you look disappointed. Not exactly Brad Pitt, is he? He, of course, began what we call the Reformation. And it was because of him we understand that God loves us and accepts us, not because of what we do. We can't earn his love. He just loves and accepts us because he chooses to call us as his children. And that all happens in baptism. Okay, here's another guy. You know who this guy is? Yes, Martin Luther King Jr. Isn't that terrible that he's more recognizable than Martin Luther? He was named, obviously, after Martin Luther. Tomorrow there's a national holiday celebrating Martin Luther King Jr. And he made it possible for us to have a civil rights bill that says all people in the United States, even though it was written in our Constitution, we finally got to the point of saying all people in the United States are equal. Doesn't matter what skin color they have. We're all equal to the and deserve the same rights as everyone. Don't you think that's neat? Martin Luther was celebrating 500 years. He nailed 95 statements or theses onto the Wittenberg Church door and became, he did that 500 years ago. So we're celebrating that happening. Two great people that we celebrate today. Let us pray. Repeat after me. Gracious God, we thank you for great people. Great people of faith. Especially Martin Luther. And Martin Luther King Jr. Help us to learn from them. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, you can go back to your seats. Well, I'm just going to say that Cranach did not do Martin Luther justice. He must have been more handsome, right? Grace and peace to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Ooh, need to turn it on. There we go. The Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. We're going to talk about that today. Let me give you a preface to this sermon before we go any further. A story. I've told you the story before. It was the story of the Roaring River mining camp. And it had nothing to do with Missouri. But in this mining camp, only men were in this camp except for one woman. That woman was pregnant, and when she gave birth to her little baby, the men didn't know what to do, and they made a makeshift bed filled with dirty rags and laid the baby there, and they were somewhat horrified, disgusted with that. So one man immediately went to the nearest town to find a crib and brought back this baby crib. Another man, because all they had were dirty rags, he went to find clean rags. And then as they all sat around admiring this baby, they realized they lived in a dump. And they began to clean it up. Life in that camp changed because of the birth of a baby. We could say life in this world should change because of the birth of a baby, the baby Jesus. But what we realize is Jesus, as the Lamb of God, taking away our sin, dying on the cross, when Jesus is born in us, it should make a huge difference in our lives. Hold on to that thought, because I might get lost. We're going to start out with the Lamb of God, the Agnus Dei. Agnus Dei, which simply means, in Latin, Lamb of God. And you're probably familiar with that symbol. The comic strip I often show you, Agnus Dei, is named Agnus Dei, Lamb of God. And it happens to have two sheep, Ted and Rick. And Ted says to Rick, I just noticed all these different names for Jesus in this story, talking about our text today. And Rick says, yeah, Lamb of God, Rabbi, Messiah. People use these old titles. They think they know him, but Jesus will give them all a richer meaning. And then Ted replies, yeah, like using one to name a comic strip. Okay, this is why I got lost last night. I tried to cover prosperity gospel, nihilism, Paul Tillich, and Rene Girard. All, you can see I've been doing too much reading. But let's look at it. Notice in this text, Jesus is the Lamb of God. John the Baptist points to him and says, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, not sins. So what can possibly be meant by sin? Obviously, we know what our sins are. Lying, cheating, stealing, lust. All those are sins. But Jesus is taking away. John the Baptist admires Jesus as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins. The sin of the world. Rene Girard and others look at this and say our main sin. Let's look at Adam and Eve. And what was their sin? Desire. God Almighty said, eat of any tree you want in the Garden of Eden, but do not eat of the tree in the center of the garden. And they have this desire placed in them by the serpent who says, oh, isn't that fruit? Doesn't it look good? And God doesn't want you to have it, because you will know then the difference between good and evil. If you eat it, you will be like God. It was too much for them to resist. You wish somebody would have come along and said this. Stop. If you seek your life, you will lose it. If you follow those desires, you're going to lose your life. If you lose your life instead, you will find it. Of course, we all know Jesus did come along and say that. Notice how the prosperity gospel plays on our desires, does it not? Somebody asked me to write a newsletter article on the prosperity gospel. This is what you're going to get. The prosperity gospel plays upon our desires, does it not? God wants you to have the desires of your heart. So if you want $10 million, God wants you to have it. And here's the answer. If you want $10 million, I want you to go out and earn $10 million. Do you know why? You're going to realize then that the $10 million, this desire of your heart, is empty. It did not complete you. It did not work. Right? You know, one of the highest, if not the highest, rate of suicide is in men over 50? Why? Excuse me, white men over 50, people who have had some measure of success, have some status, have attained the good life, only to realize, oh no, my life is still empty. Paul Tillich calls that this anxiety we all have, that it all amounts to nothing. By the way, there's a high rate of suicide among lottery winners. Just think about that. Our dreams, our desires, wind up being the very sin that destroys us. Sin causes our problems. I'm going to skip through these things. Causes conflict and come up with the scapegoat, and we're just going to have to tackle that at another time. And unless you want to be we're just going to move on. See me later, I'll tell you about it. Jesus is the pure, blameless, sinless Lamb of God. What the prophets did in the Old Testament, and we saw a glimpse of it in Psalm 40. Psalm 40 says, sacrifices you do not desire. The prophets from Isaiah, and it's all the prophets, railed against this animal sacrificial system. And they say, that's not what God desires. God wants you, not your sacrifices. God wants you. The most famous of those is the one from Micah that goes, after he says, will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000s of rivers of oil? Shall I give my firstborn for my transgression? He has told you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God. See, God wants you, your heart. Our desire, then, needs to be God's desire. The desire of our heart needs to be God and God's kingdom. Jesus, the pure and sinless Lamb of God. And we'll have to cover that later, what he meant by that. Let's talk about communion for a second. When you receive a piece of bread today, I'm going to say, or an assisting minister will say, the body of Christ given for you. And we believe that in that piece of bread, Jesus resides. Martin Luther said, in, with, and under that piece of bread. Then an assistant minister will say to you, the blood of Christ shed for you. We believe Jesus is there, in, with, and under that wine. And you'll take it in. What happened to Jesus? He's here in us, in you and me. And there, as the sinless Lamb of God on the cross, he died so that we can understand our false desires can die too. Because just as in that first story I told you, Jesus wants to be born in us, in you, in me, so that the kingdom of God can grow in us, in me, in you, among us. It's Martin Luther King Jr. weekend. And let me give you a couple of examples of how his kingdom was born in the hearts of a couple of terrible people. First is George Wallace. I was told that he ran for president. When he ran for president, he came to Springfield, Missouri, and made it one of his political stops. And he gave a speech in the square that was filled with people. And if you remember, one of his early statements was, segregation forever. Segregation now, Segregation tomorrow, segregation forever. 30 years later, now he had been put through a lot, and sometimes God Almighty puts us through a lot so that we will grow. And George Wallace, by the way, was a Christian, a United Methodist. The kingdom of God needed to grow in him. His wife died early of cancer. He was wounded by an assassin's bullet that left him in a wheelchair with pain. 30 years later, after Martin Luther King's walk in Selma, Georgia, Wallace sat in the celebration that was taken, the observance, the commemoration. He had recanted his segregation forever speech. He had met with Vivian Malone Jones, one of the students. Of course, he wanted to keep students from desegregated public schools. He wanted to keep them out of the universities. He met with one of the students that he tried to keep out. He held the hand of Joseph Lowry, Dr. King's successor, as head of the Southern Christian Leadership Conference. The kingdom of God even grew in George Wallace. Tom Long, who was at the 25th anniversary of the march to Selma, from Selma to Montgomery. He was on the same platform with George Wallace in a wheelchair with all the people who had been in that march that had survived with gray hair. And the mayor of Montgomery was the same mayor that had been the governor 25 years earlier. And he said, 25 years ago, Governor Wallace and I were wrong. We were wrong. We thought this was, again, we didn't talk about scapegoat today, but we called it, he said, outside agitation. He said, we did not know it was the coming of justice. Well, today, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, is here. He wants you to take your sin, your misplaced desire. And he's powerful enough to forgive it, to redeem it, to allow his kingdom to grow in us and among us. Amen.
Thank you. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of God.
Called to be a light to the nations, let us pray for God's justice, peace, and healing. Gracious God, help us to extend Jesus' invitation, come and see.
Form us in worship into your united people, that many shall see and stand in awe and put their trust in you. Lord, in your mercy.
Fed with bread and wine, Christ's body and blood, make us eager to care for your good creation.
Send us to pick up litter from highways and lake shores and protect animal habitats. Lord, in your mercy.
We pray for all the nations of the world.
We thank you, God, for the bishops of the Congo, united to begin a new season of democracy after much sorrow. We thank you for the talks in Geneva, Switzerland, as the United Kingdom, Greece, and Turkey aim to bring peace to the island of Cyprus. We thank you for the freedom of discourse as South Korea discerns its leadership. We thank you for leaders in this country, like Martin Luther King Jr., that have opened up to us a new world of justice. Help us to reach out to places where the scandal of hunger resides. Lord, in your mercy.
God of healing, bring hope to all whose life is a struggle and filled with despair.
Send your healing to all who suffer, especially Doreen Anno, Brandon Braxton Bennett, Janie Burnell Graves, Carolyn Callan, Jeff Dykeman, Lou Graves, Ivy Ruth Johnson, Robin Kennedy, Jerry Krakow, Alan Malcolm, Chris Marquardt, Nelson Morrison, Jack Myers, Wayne Myers, Bill Payne, Jim Raisins, Pat Roper, Jan Snath, Nellie Seward, Bonnie Turner, Rod West, and Marietta Young. Are there any others?
We thank you for the faithfulness of your prophets, especially Martin Luther King Jr.
We pray that you comfort those who mourn, especially the family and friends of Gordon Fursell. Lord, in your mercy. Receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
Merciful God, receive the gifts we bring ourselves, our time, and our possessions. Through this meal, unite us as your body, shining with the light of your justice and mercy. For the sake of him who gave himself for us, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him to be your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. All is ready. Our Lord invites us. Please come. You may be seated. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
O morning star, fair and bright, you have refreshed us again with heavenly food. You are our dearest treasure. Go with us now, today, tomorrow, every day, that we shall tell the story of your never-ending love and sing your praise both now and forever.
I have a couple of announcements. One is, next week is our annual meeting, and that will take place right after this service. It'll be between, obviously, it'll be between the two worship services. We are going to approve a budget. The approved budget is in the back, the proposed budget is in the back, and you can see there's a couple of ushers that will be handing those out. Because of the limited number of them that we have printed out, by the way, you're free not to take one, but if your family would like one, we'd like to leave it to one per family. Right now, I don't think I have anything else to announce other than read your messenger. Don't come asking me questions about something that's in the messenger. Read it. Receive this benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Guided by the gospel, we, go in peace, remember the poor.